The day prayer session will be J.C. Nagaraj Rao, retired Deputy CPO. Sri Nagaraj Rao, sir, earlier worked in Vigilance Department as Inquiry Officer and Senior Vigilance Officer. He has dealt many DIR cases and also conducted inquiries in vigilance-related cases. Over to Sri Nagaraj Rao for today's lecture session.
Okay, the parents are two types, minor parents and major parents. By seeing the name itself, we can understand. Minor keratitis means it is only minor. Minor loss to the employee. Major keratitis means major loss to the employee. Here, loss means it is a monetary loss. Loss means it is monetary. It comes from the monetary. So here, we have come for employment for the sake of salary. Do you know that? Salary is paid in terms of money only. Suppose, whatever privilege is also we are eligible. Any privilege is also calculated in terms of money only. If the privilege is withheld or withdrawn, automatically we are losing that monetary value. So here, penalties are of monetary value. If it is penalty, whatever you see, it is of monetary value. So minor penalty and major penalty. In minor penalty, we don't lose much. In major penalty, the employee has to lose more. So let us see what are the minor penalties specified in the DA rules. Whatever penalties specified in DA rules, those penalties only should be imposed on the employee. Other penalties should not be imposed. Okay. See, minor penalties are these. Number one is censure. Censure means, actual meaning is severely warned. Warning, severely warning. That is recorded warning. So all these things are there. Censure means, it is a warning, it is a recorded warning. Recorded warning means, the whatever warning letter issued to the employee, warning order issued to the employee, that will be recorded in his SR. So that's why it is called censure. Censure means warning. Both oral warning is there, written warnings are also there, but this is followed by the disciplinary action. Essential is by following the disciplinary action, this can be imposed, and once it is imposed, an order is issued that whatever penalty is essential is imposed, that should be recorded in service register of the employee. Mostly it is the degree. Then second penalty is withholding of promotion for a specific period. Withholding of promotion. So if the employee is due for promotion and he is waiting for the promotion, vacancy has come in a higher grade, and he happens to be the senior most employee. And he is fit for promotion, he is going to take a promotion. At that time, he commits any irregularity, if he violates any body of the rules, then the disciplinary action can be taken against him and this penalty can be imposed on him. So whatever penalty he is supposed to get, that can be withheld for a specific period, for a certain period, for a period of 6 months, for a period of 1 year, it is like that. Once that period is over, automatically this person will get the promotion in the next grade. While undergoing this penalty, the withholding of promotion, though he is senior most, he will not be promoted and the vacancy to pick up unfilled or it can be filled up on a hour basis by promoting it to an employee. So once this employee completes this penalty, the withholding of promotion, the period is completed, then the junior employee who is promoted on a hour basis, he will be reverted to the lower grade and this person will be promoted to that grade. So this is withholding of promotion for a specific period. See here, promotion means it is linked to the pay fixation. Pay fixation is nothing but monetary benefit to the employee. So if the promotion is not given to the employee in time, then automatically the employee will be losing the monetary benefit. The third one is, withholding of pecuniary loss caused to the railway administration due to negligence or breach of orders. See, all these words, technical words, legal words, they are mentioned in the DA rules. The same words we have used everywhere. So withholding of pecuniary loss. Suppose any loss has caused to the railway administration by the railway employee due to negligence or breach of orders or not following the orders of the railways, then whatever loss the railway administration has suffered, that will be that can be recovered from the salary of the employee. So this is one of the penalties. For example, a laptop is given to me by the administration, but the office work purpose. Suppose if I don't handle properly, I spoil it, I break it. So what is the cost of that laptop income? That can be recovered from my salary. But it is as a measure of penalty. To recover that, we have to go for the disciplinary action at the same time. We have to take disciplinary action. The procedure should be followed and that penalty can be imposed. But this can be recorded in the service register. Next, withholding of privilege passes and PTOs are good. So you know, every employee, they are eligible for privilege passes as well as PTO, privilege ticket order, while in service, as well as after retirement. Though the employee does not get the privilege pass, he is eligible for post retirement compensation passes. But as long as we are in service, we are eligible for privilege passes as well as privilege ticket orders. How many passes are eligible to use the employee in the service after completion of 5 years from the date of his appointment? 3 sets of passes, privilege passes, he is eligible. Similarly, he is eligible for 4 sets of PTOs in any year. After retirement, we don't get PTOs. After retirement, we don't get retirement passes. We get only post-retirement complementary passes, PRC passes in this one. So, because of privilege process and PTOs are good. This is also one of the minor penalties. So, once this penalty is imposed, so once for all, employee will use that pass as well as PTO for that year. Though the name is withholding of increment, it will not be released after that period. Suppose this 2021, when employee finishes some PTO, passes are withheld to presume. So, he will not get any, privilege pass during this year. Next year only he has to get his three sets of passes for 2022. 2021 passes, whatever he lost, that will be lost forever. It will not be restored to the next year. This is one of the minor penalties in the NLS. Similarly, PTOs also. The fifth minor penalty is reduction of pay by one stage with the current level. Reduction of pay by one stage with current level for not more than 3 years without cumulative effect, without affecting settlement benefits. So these are the lower conditions with direction of pay. So you know very well, once we are appointed, we will be appointed in some level as per 750C pay matrix. So once we are appointed in some level, our pay starts with level 1, sorry, cell 1. Cell 1 of us are paid. Every year we will get the increment. So we will move from cell 1 to cell 2, cell 2 to cell 3, cell 2 to cell 3 to cell 4. Like that, every year we will get the increment, we will be moving ahead like that. Suppose penalty is imposed with reduction of pay, so his pay will be reduced to the lower level. His pay will be reduced to the lower level. So that is the reduction of pay. What are the conditions? By one stage only. You should not be more than one stage. You should not be two stages, three stages, four stages. Pay should not be reduced to more than one stage in minor penalty cases. And you should not be more than 3 years. See, reduction is for a temporary period. It should not be for a permanent period. If the pay is reduced by one stage of any employee, in an ERK, we should be only for a specified period, that is for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. We should not have permanent nature. Similarly, without cumulative effect means recurring effect. What is cumulative, what is not cumulative, I will tell you. Then without affecting the settlement benefits. And by imposition of this penalty, the employee's settlement dues should not be get affected. How will not get affected? So you know very well, settlement dues means pension and gratuity. Pension and gratuity is deducted based on the pay loss done by the employee at the time of retirement. So if the pay is reduced to the lower level, automatically employees will pay settlement is going to deducted only on reduced pay. So by reduced pay, calculating of reduced pay, employee will suffer a great monetary loss. If we calculate on the original pay, employee will be benefited. If it is calculated on the reduced pay, employee will suffer great loss. The recurring loss for him, pension will be fixed at the lower level, as well as gratuity is also calculated at the lower state. So that's why this should not be there. So in the minor penalty case, the reduction of pay by one stage in current level, not more than 3 years, without cumulative effect, without affecting the settlement benefits. Now let us see what is cumulative effect, what is not cumulative. Suppose for example, Mr. A and Mr. B both are appointed in railways in the same post to RRB. So initially, I will tell one example, not correct to pay, I am telling. So initially, their basic pay is fixed at 10,000 rupees. Here, 10,000 rupees, there, 10,000 rupees. Don't think that 10,000 basic pay is not fixed. I am telling an example for easy understanding. So 10,000 basic pay is fixed. So after completion of 1 year service, both will get one increment. So if you presume, increment that is 1,000 rupees. So A will get pay 11,000 rupees, B also get pay 11,000 rupees. So both are at the same stage. So second year also they got the increment. Increment rate is 1,000 rupees. Then A's pay will become 1,000, B's pay also will become 1,000. So next another third year, they are supposed to get increment in the month of July, first of July. So if they get increment of first of July, his pay will become, A's pay will become 13,000, B's pay also will become 13,000. But unfortunately, B's pay, B involved in the case, the action is taken and his pay is reduced from 2,000 to 11,000. So, for a period of 1 year. So, during this 1 year period, he will draw only 11,000. Whereas, his friend, Mr. A, will be drawing 4,000. But B's pay is reduced from 2,000 to 11,000 for a period of 1 year. Meanwhile, increment date has come. So, A is progressing, A's pay is increased to 13,000, but B will continue to draw only the 11,000 only for 1 year. After completion of 1 year, if it is a non-cumulative effect punishment, without cumulative effect punishment, B square will be restored to the normal. Whatever A is getting, the same thing will be given to B also. 30,000, 30,000 will be given. If it is a recurring, then B square will be restored to 12,000, whereas A square will be 13,000. Because he is not having any punishments. A will be getting equipment every year, that smart equipment also he got, his pay has become 13,000. But B has suffered the punishment, that's why this penalty, that's why he will be paid with me, 12,000 only equipment here. Like that, every year, B will be able to go in further, but A will be lagging behind. That is recurring loss to the employee. It is a recurring loss to the employee. That is the difference between the cumulative effect, non-cumulative effect, or it is called the recurring effect or non-recurring effect. So if it is a minor penalty, the reduction of pay will be only without cumulative effect, without recurring effect. That is we have to keep in mind. So these are the four conditions for reduction of pay. Let us go to the another minor penalty. Because of final increment for a specific period, with the direction whether it will have or not have the effect of postponing for future. So, returning of annual increment, suppose employee for annual increment, if that is with that punishment will cause that penalty is called minor penalty. What direction with the directions whether it will have or will not have the effect of postponing for future increment. So, this is the condition. If it is not, which is not having effect of postponing increment means, after completion of this penalty period, he will get his original pay, what he is supposed to get. If it is a recurring effect, he will not get his original pay, he will get only one increment, like that he will be lagging behind. It is a permanent loss to the employee. So these are the minor penalties. So let us see major penalties. What are the major penalties in the year? Major penalties are reduction of pay in the current level by any number of agents for more than 3 years with a cumulative effect. This condition. There, these conditions, their minor penalty conditions are different. Here, major penalty conditions are different. Next, the direction to lower level, or grade, or post, or service, with a further direction regarding restoration, seniority, and fixation of pay. Direction to lower level, one level to another level reduction, one grade to another grade reduction, or one post to another post reduction, or service to another service reduction. But from higher level, higher service to lower service. Higher post to lower post, it is like this. With the further direction regarding restoration, whether it is a permanent nature or a condition of the punishment period, whether it is to be restored or not, the condition should be mentioned in the purpose of the that is penalty order. Then seniority. So once he is restored to the original post, how his seniority is to be fixed? Whether he will regain his original seniority or he will lose the seniority during that period, for the period of penalty. And fixation of it. What is fixed upon restoration? With the original post. So all this should be mentioned with the district authority while imposing this major penalty. Then compulsory retirement, removal from service, and dismissal from service. All these are major penalties. Once the compulsory retirement is issued, the employee will not be kept with the service. He will be compulsorily retired, and whatever settlement you see, the people have to be paid. The employee removal from service or dismissal from service, the employee will not get any settlement benefits except his own PF balance with interest. That he will. Other things he will not get. So that's why, if removal of the dismissal service is imposed, it's a very big loss to the employee. So what is the difference between the removal and dismissal means? Then what the capacity to both are same, but there is a difference between removal and dismissal from service. Once the employee, right by employee, the removal from service, there is a possibility for him again to appear for any competitive exam, either in the state government or central government or provincial or undertaking, and again he can get the job. But if the employee is dismissed from service, he cannot be recruited or appointed in any of the state government or central government or provincial or other things. That is the difference between the removal and dismissal from service. Okay. Just let us go through how what is the procedure we have to follow before the minor penalty. This elaborate procedure is there, but our subject is not there. The subject is different. But before taking you to the subject, just as I have given this introduction. What is the procedure we have to follow the imposition of minor penalty? Issue of charge memo in standard form number 11 under the signature of the discipline attorney. This is the first and foremost thing what we have. The charge memo order should be issued in standard form number 11. So, the standard form number 11 is the same for entire India members. It has to be given. This is totally standard form designed by the Railway Board and it is as per the DOT instructions and that only we have to follow. So, totally it will have legal language. So this chart number, we have issued this chart number for limit under the signature of the disciplinary authority. Disciplinary authority means an authority who is competent to take disciplinary action under that particular entity. You know, in our life, there are many grades of it, from lower 10 to higher 10, level 1 to level 17, 18, up to level 4, many levels of it. For each level employee, particular level officer only is the disciplinary authority. So, the disciplinary authority will be decided based on the level of the employee, which level the employee is working, and who will be the competent authority to take disciplinary action against this employee. This can be seen only from the schedule of powers attached to the disciplinary TR books. So, schedule of powers are there. According to the schedule of powers, the disciplinary authority will be decided depending upon the level of the employee. So, the charge number should be signed only by the same disciplinary authority, not lower authority or any other authority. So, disciplinary authority should sign the charge memo under his own signature. We should not delegate this work to his subordinates. And 10 days time will be given to the employee to submit his explanation. Because here, disciplinary action is nothing but quasi judicial nature. It is acting quasi judicial nature. So, judicial nature means we should not punish the employee without hearing from him. Suppose a complaint has come against one employee, so, based on that the complaint, immediately we cannot go to impose the penalty on the employee. We have to hear from the employee also. What is his work, whether he has done this mistake or not. If whatever he has done, to what extent he has done, whether he is liable for the full punishment or any lesser punishment, that is to be decided. So, judiciously, the punishment is to be, the penalty is to be imposed on the employee. So, that's why we have to give him the charge memo and call for his explanation. So, employee will give the charge memo, what mistake he has committed, what rule he has violated, what is specifically mentioned in the chart program. So, employee will go to the applications made against him in the chart program, then he will do the explanation, denying the charges and explaining circumstances and situation under which he has committed that. So, that explanation should be examined carefully by the disciplinary authority, because he wants to take disciplinary action against the employee, he has issued the chart program to him. So, that's why the same disciplinary authority should go through that explanation, understand it. And then we have to decide whether employee has been completely responsible or is not responsible or to what extent he is responsible. He has to decide. Then he has to pause the speaking orders. Speaking orders means it is writing a judgment. You might have seen many court judgments. So in that, elaborately the judgment will be written. What is the charge? What is the defense of the employee? How far the defense can be accepted? If not all not accepted, why we cannot accept his explanation? All those things have to be recorded with the disciplinary authority in the file, and then he has to indicate the penalty imposed on the employee. So this is not speaking. So what are speaking orders is recorded in the file by the disciplinary authority that is to be communicated to the employee through penalty order under the signature of the same disciplinary authority. Normally we do. Some officer will pass the orders in the file, but that will be communicated by the lower level officer.
May have a big loss, big loss in the service. He may be dismissed from service, he may be compulsory retired, he may lose his job, he may be removed from service, or he may be reduced to the lower post or lower grade. So these are all very senior punishments. A lot of one who lost the day to the employee. So that's why, by imposing this penalty, it should be done properly. That's why the detailed procedure has been made on in the agency. So the procedure for imposing a major penalty is like this. First, we have to issue charge sheet to the employee in the standard form number 5. So, there, the minor penalty is given in the standard form number 11. Whereas, in major penalty cases, we have to use standard form number 5. In the prescribed standard form, you get to pay the value for as per the legal duties expenses. It should be under the signature of the disciplinary authority. Here also, we have to see what is the penalty, major penalty, what is the level of the employee, and who is the competent authority to take the major penalty disciplinary action to the employee. That should be seen from the schedule of powers. Suppose any lower authority is issuing that charge sheet to the employee means, then it will become purchase that action. Because in purchase, in corporate head of the law, you cannot take this simple action after the employee. Only the corporate head of the law should take this simple action after the employee. That's why every time we have to see the schedule of hours. Then, this charge, this major penalty charge is, will have four annexes. Four arrangements will be there. Four annexes. We call that annexion 1, annexion 2, annexion 3, and annexion 4. But minor penalty charge, no annexes will be there. Only statement of imputation will be there. That is, what is the charge? What are the irregularities he has committed? What are the rules he has violated? That will show it. But here it is not like that. We have to do four enclosures. Four enclosures, that is annexion 1, 3, and 4. Let us see what is annexion 1. Annexion 1 is statement of article of charge. Statement of what? It is a statement of article of charge. Article or articles of charge. So there may be one charge or many charges. So here we classify them as article, articles. So article of charge. So what is the charge? The charge will be very brief. For example, I will tell you, there is one assault case, Bima assault. So normally, on supervisory official is there. Under him, one could be employed. Now, who see? Say he is a PU, or somebody is working, one PU is working, other is coming. On supervisor is there. So one day, there is some issue has come. There was a argument was there between these two people, and this PU has accused the supervisory officer with unparliamentary language, and he has gone up to the stage of beating him also. This is an incident has taken place. I am telling one example. In office, an incident has taken place. Then what will happen? The supervisory officer immediately, he will give a complaint under the PU to the higher officer, senior DFM or DFM, he will complain. Then the DFM or senior DFM, they want to initiate disciplinary action against the DFM. So before going for disciplinary action, initially, a bad-pending inquiry will be ordered, bad-pending inquiry. So we want to know, because only one complaint has come from the supervisor. SSO has made a complaint to the DFM or senator. So he will order from the bad-pending inquiry. It is only bad-pending, not a DFM, bad-pending inquiry. So then he will nominate some inspector, DIA or somebody. So he will tell that, just to inquire into the matter and give me the report, bad-pending inquiry. Then this inspector, what he will do? He will go to that office. And he will call all the people who were present on the day, at the time of this incident. He will take the statements from each and every one, individually, separately. So those people will give their statements in writing under their signature. So they narrate everything, what has happened, what they have seen, what they have heard. Everything they will write and give. So, basing on that, now, disciplinary action will be taken under the tribune by issue of the major penalty charge. Because serious matter, it is totally disciplined. So the behavior is very bad. So that's why major penalty action will be taken after the tribunal. So now we are charging in the standard form 5, we have to be. So in that part we are going to tell in article of charge, annexure 1, simply we say that aunt also dead, aunt also dead, in so-so office, you have misbehaved with the supervisory officer, Mr. So-so-so. And you have used the unfollowing language and you have met him also. It's very simple. This is article of charge. So you cannot find anything in that. Just it is only the simple article, simple charge. So next, coming to the annexion, it is a statement of imputations of misconduct and misbehavior. The second statement is statement of imputations of misconduct. It is imputations. Here, what we say, we elaborately write. Charge elaborately will write. One will write, see, arm so-so did, and so-so said. You are up to the office at 9 o'clock. You have put signature in the attendance register. Then so-so, superintendent official, SSO, has asked this to do this work, but you have refused to do that. Then, further, you started arguing with him in the presence of so many people. You abused them, abused him in some pretty language, and you have many more in the presence of so-so. All these things happened at so-so time. Then, recorded in the statement of imputations. So here, article of charge is different and imputations are different. Article of charge is very brief, imputations are very elaborate. Then, list of related upon documents. So, related upon documents means for everything, for every incident. Certainly, there will be related upon documents. Because we are working in government office, all our working is on the record only. So, for everything, paper record will be there. So, these records are called related upon documents. In the case, example, what I do, what is the related upon document? So he has come at 9 o'clock and put signature in the attendance register. So attendance register is one of the delayed upon documents. So to prove that he has come to the But he may say that, so, sir, on the day I am not going to come to the office, I have not put signature in the attendance list, but he may tell me the entry. So, through that, this attendance list is one of the requirements of the office. Then, complaint of the SSO. So, the complaint what the SSO has given to the secretary of the market, this employee, that is one of the related upon office, that is second complaint. Then, the report given by the backhanding authority. It may be shown as a RP report, it may not be shown as RP. It's obvious. And the statement what he has obtained from all people who are present in the office, those statements will become related upon documents. Because actually, if there are three people or four people present in that office on the day, all the AS are there, JS are there, other people are also there. So their statements were recorded on this. So these things are the related upon documents. So all these documents will prove the charge payment is same. So what the connection we will say, what are the list of documents basing on which we are getting the charge and the list of witnesses. So eyewitness. So this is very, very important. For every incident, there will be an eyewitness. For every incident, there will be an eyewitness. Unless it is taken in isolation places. So if the office has taken place, so many people have seen, they have got the statement, whoever has got the statement, all these people are the witnesses for the discharge. So tomorrow in the inquiry, these people will come before the inquiry officer and they will tell orally also. Now they are given in writing. Tomorrow they will confirm what they have given in writing before the inquiry officer in support of the charges given to the same. So these actions are very, very important. If witness is not there, there is no charge. If it already is not there, you cannot prove the charge. So entire action what to take in the same way will go in vain. So that's a list of related upon offense, list of witnesses are very, very necessary. Then, when the assignment is given to the employee to submit his representation, the employee will go through the charges payment and testing. Then, he will give his explanation or his representation, denying the charges, explaining his defense point. Then, because it is a major penalty charge, straight away major penalty can be imposed. DR inquiry should be connected. Without connecting DR inquiry, we cannot impose major penalty. But in minor penalty, DR inquiry is not required based on implicit prescription, straight away major penalty can be imposed. But in major penalty cases, we cannot impose major penalty without conducting the DR inquiry. So who will conduct the inquiry? How the inquiry is conducted? Is a subject for the So the discipline that you want to do, you need to nominate one inquiry officer, IO. Here it is IO, inquiry, IMP2I. Many people will write inquiry, EMP2I. EMPL means that our vision is office will open the inquiring about the operation and the fixture. So that is inquiry. Here is the inquiry officer, IMP. So nomination of IO and the presenting officer. One presenting officer will be there on behalf of the district attorney to present the case in the inquiry. Then defense helper. Defense helper, the employee will choose. Chartered employee has started the inquiry before the inquiry officer. He gives his defense and he can take the assistance of some serving employee or retired employee. As his assistant, he is not defense helper, not defense assistant, not defense person. Different names we call. But defense helper normally we call. Then, conducting of inquiry as per the rules and the procedures by the inquiry officer. The next stage is the inquiry officer will conduct the inquiry as per the rules and procedures that we are going to see now. And then, he will submit the inquiry report to the inquiry officer. After completion of the inquiry, he will submit the report to the inquiry officer. And then, he will submit the report to the disciplinary authority. The inquiry officer report on this from the inquiry officer, the decision was that he immediately not jump to go for imposing the penalty. He has to submit the copy of the report, the inquiry officer report to the charging official and mark on his representation on that report. So once the employee submits his representation on inquiry officer report, then the decision was that he thoroughly go through the entire case, inquiry officer's report, charging employee's representation and inquiry report, then he has to come to a conclusion whether the employee is responsible or not responsible, whether penalty can be imposed on him or not. If so, what type of penalty should be imposed? Definitely, he has to recall in the file as a speaking order. So, I told you what is speaking order again. So, he has to detail the penalty depending and he imposed the penalty. So, whatever penalty he is imposing, that will be communicated to the employee in the form of penalty order under the signature of same disciplinary authority. So this is how major penalty can be imposed on the employee. In nutshell, I have told you. Let us go to the inquiry form. How inquiry is conducted? It's very, very important for the superintendent officials because they may be asked to present the inquiry. So if the employer is not attended as per the rules, so tomorrow employee go to the court and has to attend the report, court will set aside the entire proceedings and employer will be let free. So that's why the inquiry officer will conduct the inquiry should be very, very thorough with the rules. Everything is there in the entire rules. That is important. See, when the PR inquiry is ordered, who are the parties in the PR inquiry? Who is there in the PR inquiry? Means here, inquiry officer appointed by the authority. He is not separate designation, he is not there. Inquiry officer separate designation is not, it is there could be in the department. In non-vigilance cases, some supervisory officer will be nominated as inquiry officer to conduct the inquiry. Sometimes some officers also will be nominated to conduct the inquiry depending upon the gravity of the case. Then presenting officer will get it. What is this presenting officer PO? Presenting officer means he will present the case on behalf of the administration in the inquiry before inquiry officer. He will present the case. You might have seen prosecution lawyers, you might have seen government lawyers in court. It is like that. Government lawyers will present the case from government side. It is like that. So the presenting officer will present the case on behalf of the disciplinary authority before the inquiry officer. Is not presenting officer. He may be some other some supervisor officer or some clerk, somebody may be there. And charge number, you know, very the person who has issued the charge. He is not charged with it. This person also is participating in the inquiry. He should be there. Without him, there will not be any inquiry. So, charge with employee must be there. Then, he is a defense member. The charge with employee can bring one person participating in the inquiry as a defense. The reason for that is, one, whatever may be, he may be very good in the rules, he is very senior man, he is very experienced person. Even then, he cannot defend his case properly because it is his case, normally he will have that fear that he may not present his case properly, he cannot present his defense properly. That's why, to defend his case, he may bring one person who is well versed in the rules, who knows the subject very well, to submit his defense in the inquiry. So that's why that person is more defensive. Then prosecution witnesses will be there. Prosecution witnesses means the people on behalf of the judge, on behalf of the judge, on behalf of the judge. I told you in example, all the people who are AS and JS who are present there, they give the statement. They record the statement, they put on the basic basis. These people are called prosecution witnesses. And defense witnesses also will be there. Defense witnesses means employee can bring here some witnesses on his behalf. So to say that, he has not committed the criminal guilty. For that purpose, he can bring his witnesses also. They are not defense witnesses in the case. Okay? His prosecution witnesses, defense helper. Here, defense helper means he should be a serving employee or retired employee of the particular zone, not from other zone. Suppose it is the case of South Central Railway, means only South Central Railway officials will be the defense helper, not Southern Railway or Western Railway or North Railway. So, because it is the interest of the administration to finance the case only, so we have to engage only the certificate number from the same railway or retired from the same railway. Sometimes what will happen? Some employee might have retired in Kolkata railway, but he has settled in South Central railway. He has settled in South Central railway. Now his residency is at South Central. Thus, such a retired employee can also be taken as defense number because it is readily available here. The retired officer from North Central Delhi has to come every time and go is financially loss, expenditure for us, as well as the different party to come and go, as well as if it doesn't come, inquiry has to get postponed, and DR action, finalization of DR action will get delayed. So that's why as well as carpool, as well as carpool, it should be from the same railway. These are the people, these are the parties in the DR inquiry. No other person will be there. So no other person will be allowed to combine to sit in the inquiry. Let us see, what is the role of presenting? So before going, in the inquiry officer's room, let us see the presenting officer. Because he is giving the report to the inquiry room and presenting in the inquiry before inquiry officer, let us see what is the duty of the presenting officer. The presenting officer is nominated by the disciplinary authority to present the case in the inquiry. He will give all the report to them. So let us see. Presenting officer is an employee or officer nominated by the disciplinary authority to present the case before the inquiry officer during the course of the year inquiry. The second thing is, The primary function of the presenting officer is to master facts before the inquiry officer and to examine and cross-examine the witnesses produced during the inquiry. Here, the primary function is he has to master the witnesses as well as document the evidence before the inquiry officer. Means he has to produce all the witnesses in support of the judge, all the document evidence in support of the judge before the inquiry officer. Because based on the witness's statement as well as witnesses only, the charges are favored against the employee that can be proved only if these are confirmed in the course of the inquiry. So it is his primary responsibility. It is not bringing the witnesses in the inquiry, prosecution witnesses, a charge cannot be proved. Charge cannot be proved without witness confirming the statement. Then charge cannot be proved by the inquiry officer. So PO should assist the IPO during preliminary hearing to sort out the preliminaries. The PO, the presiding officer, should assist the IPO if the job is processed in the IPO during preliminary hearing. Preliminary hearing means before starting the main inquiry, a hearing. Hearing means first hearing, second hearing, third hearing, it will be late. No near inquiry will be conducted completed within one day. This is where cases it will be completed one day. So that's why the preliminary hearing, whatever doubts the inquiry officer is having, or whatever doubts the defense helper or charged employee is having, those doubts he has to clear. He has to clear in the preliminary hearing. If he is not able to clear in the preliminary hearing, he can take time, go back, and get clarification from disciplinary authority or back many inquiry who has conducted that particular inspector or particular officer. Then next day he can come and explain to him. He can clarify the doubts. So all the doubts, whatever the charged employee or defense helper or the inquiry officer are having, he has to clear it. It is his job, the presiding officer's job. For that, he should thoroughly go through the charges carefully and understand the charges framed against the witness. For that, the PO, what he has to do, well in advance, he has to read the entire charge. Carefully, he has to read. He should understand. Then only he will be able to present the case, present his case on behalf of the administration in the inquiry. He should read all the documents carefully and understand them to present them in the inquiry in a proper manner. He should read all the documents, any of our documents I told you. So he should read each and every document very carefully and understand that and keep in mind. So before basing on these documents only, charges will be proved. If the documents are proved that the documents are not correct, the charge cannot be proved in the inquiry. So always the defense assistant as a charging employee will be trying to disprove the documents, disprove what is written in the document. So that's why the inquiry is presenting documents should be very thorough. We should go through the documents very carefully. There will be a number of documents. If a small case, only two documents should be there. A derailment case, accident case, or some other related car case, or many documents should be there. We have to read each and every document very carefully, take time. Then only you should ask the inquiry officer to fix the time, date for the inquiry. So he has to do this one. We should discuss with the investigating officer well in advance and get all his notes cleared. So the officer who has investigated into the case, we have to discuss with him. He should get all his notes clarified and keep them on fingerprints so that nobody will be there to assist him during the course of the inquiry. The presenting officer only will be there on behalf of the decision maker. Nobody will come to his rescue in the inquiry room. He cannot take the assistance of anybody. So that's why presenting officer should have to do an audit for the charges as well as the data documents, everything, as well as rules connected to that case. We should acquaint himself fully with the departmental rules and technical aspects of the issue. So that is what it is. So he should be well acquainted with the departmental rules. What are the rules we have violated, we have shown in the charge sheet for the charge sheet. So those rules, we should thoroughly go through them. There is every possibility for him to interpret the rules in different way. We may be seeing many people who will be discussing on that. They will be disputing on that. So once you can read any rule, we understand initially in one way. The other people, they come and start discussing with us, asking with us that who will not like that, which is like this. So, because it is English. So, that's why what will happen, my understanding will be different and other person's understanding will be different. So, that's why all these things, we cannot take anybody's assistance for clarification in the inquiry. So, before coming to the inquiry itself, we should anticipate what are the questions are going to the hospital by the chartered employee on this particular rule. All those things he should be keep ready and he should be in a position to clarify them in the inquiry before the inquiry officer. You should supply the copies of documents in support of the charges and allow the inspection of the original documents by the CE as well as his defense. So normally original documents will be given the disciplinary authority only. We will not view original documents to the charged employee or to the charge. We will view only the photocopies, attested photocopies only will be given. But in the inquiry, Simply cannot be conducted basing on the attested photocopies of the documents. So, original documents are must in the inquiry. Inquiry officer should see the original documents with his own eyes. As well as the charge employee, he demands to see the original documents. His defense helper also wants to see the original documents. That's why, whatever related upon documents we have shown in the charge sheet in Annexure 3, those original documents we must bring. If original documents are not produced before the inquiry, then the document will not have any value. On account of that, we may use the case. The charge may not be proved, cannot be proved. So, original document is must. For the side, the dating officer should collect the original documents wherever they are and keep it them carefully. And you should not give it in the hands of somebody else, because there is a very possibility that somebody may tamper with the document, the original part. So, he should process the document and keep it carefully and should show to the charge employee in the presence of IO. There also should be very careful. In the inquiry room, the charge employee or his defense helper may do something. All people will not. There is a possibility that some people may try to tamper the record. So he should be very careful and watch. He should not use the documents on the table of the inquiry officer and go outside to talk to the phone or somebody. So always should be very careful in the inquiry room and he should not use the original documents. That is very, very important duty of the presenting officer. We should produce original documents in support of charges to enable the IO to take them on record and mark them on the transcription if it's needed. So these documents have to be shown to the inquiry officer to take them on record. Because without taking them on record, inquiry cannot be produced for them. So they should be taken on record and they should be marked as exhibits. Mark means each document will be given one number. Transcription document, PD1, PD2, PD3. In annexure, we give one number for that. Annexure 1, Annexure 2, Annexure 3, we give the number to the documents. But here, the same documents will be given different numbers. But we see that different sequence will be arranged, and then according to the convenience of the IO, he will do the numbers to those documents. He will record it with his reading card, with greeting. He will write exhibit for exhibit. He should read them. What are these documents he is bringing in support of his defense? Then he has to read them and understand them. And tomorrow in the inquiry, he should prove that these documents are not relevant to the case like that. Otherwise, based on those documents, the judge will probably that the inquiry officer may say that the charges are not true. So he has to always be ready to say that these documents are not relevant to the inquiry. But are relevant also, then get the modification.
సార్ అన్మ్యూట్ చేసుకోండి సార్ మీరు ఒక్కడితే అన్మ్యూట్ చేయండి సార్ కైండ్లీ otherwise I am coming.
Charges are not included in this case. He's only started as an employee, but whatever respect he has to get, that respect should be given by the name of the charging employee as well as his defense employee. Then you should ensure that prosecution witnesses are not harassed by the defense employee by putting irrelevant and indecent and scandalous questions. We have already learned from the incident. The prosecution witnesses will come to the witness before the inquiry officer. At that time, the cross examination will be done by the defense helper. The defense helper, what he will try to harass the witness because he will tell the truth in support of the charge. Like if he tells truth in support of the charge, the charges will be true and then get punished. So that's why all the defense helper will try to harass the witness and then take irrelevant questions. So immediately, the benefit officer should write objection to the report and tell them that some questions should not be asked. To please control the defense helper not to ask such questions. You should follow carefully the cross examination of prosecution witnesses by seeing and re examining them only on the necessary important aspects. So, during cross examination, defense helper will ask many questions to these prosecution witnesses. The prosecution witnesses think in the process, they get bugged. The questions are asked in such a way, any employee or anybody to the matter, they get bugged and they give different version of the answer. So, it means contradictory. Whatever they are doing, the statement, whatever he is telling here properly, will be different. Then what will happen? Yes, it will fail. Yes, it will fail. So that's why he should carefully examine what questions he will be
asked.
And both of them, whenever any clarification is prepared, any confusion is created. So in the re-examination, he should put the question to the witness and get them clarified. For example, I told you, the previous example. So, when I know what this incident has taken place, then defense helper will ask the witness, that AA is the one of the witnesses. Okay? Before that, by time of my he will tell, by what time you have come to the office, he will ask, sir, I came at about 9 o'clock. So, you came by what car you came by bike. He says that, sir, I came by bike. Where you parked your bike? I parked my bike in the scooter stand. So, what is the distance between scooter stand to your office? It is so many meters. So, how much time you take you put to come up to your office from the scooter stand? I have taken 5 minutes. So, if this you reach the office at 9:05. So, 9:05 you reach the office, but incidents have taken place at 9:00. It means at 9:00 the incident was taken place, you were not present in the office. So, you are not seeing anything. But in your statement, you told that you have seen that at 9:00 you have abused the SS. But when you are not in the office at 9:00, how can you say that you have seen that he is abusing the SSO? Like that in cross exam. Then whatever statement this witness has given, that will become false. So the statement will not have any value. If the statement doesn't have any value, automatically charge will become weak and the employee, the charges will become hard. So all kinds of things will be like that. That's why the presenting officer carefully listen to the questions what defense expert is asking, as well as what test this witness is giving. All those things you should note on, and in re-examination, you should again put the question to the witness and get them clarified. On the completion of the inquiry, here you should collect the copies of the daily proceedings of the IVO without fail. Every day, whatever proceedings are taken place, the IVO will give one copy to the presenting officer as well as charging employee. One copy will keep the chip for not to be copied in the IVO. And whatever they can give, whatever questions asked, whatever answers are given, all the things will be kept tight, then they will be. And signatures of all these people will be obtained. Presenting officer, defense helper, charging employee, and also inquiry officer also will sign on the paper. And one cent will be given to the presenting officer. Presenting officer should not forget to collect the copies. So that, on the completion of inquiry, viewers should prepare the prosecution brief carefully, bringing out all the evidence, that is documentary as well as oral, that has come on the record during the inquiry in support of the charge, and submit it to the IO within the given time to enable the IO to be discussed. Once the inquiry is over, now what will happen? Immediately, the inquiry officer will not know his proceedings, he will not give his credits to the discipline authority. The inquiry officer will just go to the PO as well as CO, that is charged to the employee, to give them briefs. So, first of all, this person has to do the brief. The IO has to do the brief. What IO has done studying this, the presenting officer will give his brief. Brief means he will tell what are the things have come in the inquiry, how he put able to do the charge, documentary as well as oral evidence. All those things he will mention, and he will just take care of the, because of sounds also, the just charges are due in the inquiry. So, basic order is you report to the district authority. He will give a report, he will give the prosecution to the inquiry officer within the given checklist. So with that, the role of the presenting officer is to go. So here, with the personal records, here, we will bring the witnesses, we should examine them, and we should allow the witnesses to cross-examine the defense member, and we should be very careful in having the records by listening to the offers of the witnesses, and similarly, we have to cross-examine the defense member very carefully, all the things. And finally, we have to do his prosecution to the inquiry officer in support of his office. Then let us see. Or of the defense assistants or defense helper or defense force. This person will play a very important role because he has to help the employee to bail out of the charges. Defense helper should be railway employee or their railway. I told you already. He may be from any department. CE should obtain permission from the disciplinary authority by something CE must report to one employee and he will ask, can he report to one of his friends? And he will ask, sir, the charges has come to me. Now inquiry is ordered, why don't you come and help me in this case? I want your help, I can go and ask. Then that person will say that, okay, I will come and help you. I have given my willingness letter to that. That is for concept level. So the willingness letter he has obtained from him, and he has to go to the disciplinary authority. And then the disciplinary authority, sir, I want to take the social person assistance. In the inquiry, you please permit me to take his assistance. Then disciplinary authority will do permission to him to bring that person to the inquiry to assist him in the inquiry. So that is. Everything will be in writing. A serving affair should not have more than 3 cases on hand at the time as a defense helper. The defense helper should not have more than 3 year cases in his hand as a defense helper. If we more than 3 cases, why we are not giving? Because more than 3 cases are handled by him, he will not be available for the normal working. Because he may be some SO of some other officer or OS of some other officer. Or he may be from traffic inspector or station master, something. So, in all the cases, he is not doing many cases like this. He is not available for his work. So, that's why the number is restricted. A retired employee should not have more than 7 cases on hand. So, retired employees, they can have 7 cases in their hand. More than that, they will not be permitted. Defense helper should go to the charges carefully and understand their problem. He has to do, otherwise, he cannot defend the case in the inquiry. You should go through all the related upon documents carefully and understand them properly. What people have to say, the same thing people have to do, the defense. The key code, we should go through the all rules and regulations of the subject case and understand it properly. If a DP is from the other department or if it is from a particular technical department, you can easily understand it properly. Suppose he is from some other department, it is difficult for him to understand the technical facts. Suppose I am there. I can defense helper in accounts case. Some card has taken place or something has taken place. Because I don't know the accounts case. So, for that, actually, to add the defense helper in the case, I should come up to the rules. I should read, understand, discuss some single people or individual people. Because if they don't mean, I can come and defend the case. It is 7 cases. You can ask for personal documents, he's needed for documents. Parents there and satisfied. So he has to demand for personal documents. Sometimes personal documents cannot be there. So for basically, He can also produce the relevant additional documents in support of his defense and request the IO to take them on record and mark the documents. Suppose the defense helper is having some other documents with him in support of his defense, then he can produce them before the IO and ask him to take them on record and mark them as defense documents. He has to show the original also. He has to put photocopies to the IO to take them on record. He can also give the list of the defense witnesses to inform him them. The course of interview. So he can read some witnesses also. He has to do the names and designations and the officers where they are working. Then all those list he has to put to the inquiry officer and the past inquiry officer to summon them for the inquiry as a defense witnesses. Because he cannot go and call the person to come and attend the inquiry. Because for everything, I want permission to the director of the function. That's why he will ask them, the IO, to call these people for the inquiry. So I want to send letters to those two officers. And ask those supervisors to be known to clients to come and view the witness because we have had the witness to the judge level. You should be alert to throw the inquiry. The defense helper should be alert to throw the defense throw the inquiry because if he is helping the judge level, any failure on his part will result into the penalty to the judge level. Then a judge level has to suffer. The judge level has to get trust on him, then he has to compulsorily be just into his job. So that's why he should be. Thoroughly present in the inquiry room as well as you should carefully listen to the inquiry proceedings. He should cooperate with the inquiry officer and presenting officer for army veterans from the inquiry. He should cooperate with the inquiry officer also as well as presenting officer for army veterans from the inquiry. Here, inquiry means nothing but questioning and examining and cross examining. His witnesses will question and he will cross examine. For his witnesses, he is PO to question and this is right. Different number of questions and I will be able to ask it. So, it is like that. I will be sitting hiding and observing everything and putting everything. You should carefully listen to the prosecution witnesses during the examination when you go and note down the important parts to seek the clarification in the prosecution. All these things here. You should not agree to recall the prosecution witnesses for examination once again to fill up the gaps of the evidence already recorded. Once a witness, prosecution witness is examined and cross examined. And again, you should not depart from the examination. Once the witness is coming to view the evidence in the inquiry, entire thing should be completed then and there only. If only few questions asking, sending him away, and calling him on some other day, again putting on some other questions, it is not possible with the DR inquiry. Once a witness comes, whatever questions are to be asked from both sides, that should be asked, and whatever answers he is giving, that should be recorded. And it should be reviewed to go back to the examiner. So he should talk to someone again and again to the inquiry. Then sometimes presenting officer will attempt to bring that witness once again for examination. Then the defense expert should say that no, it is not permissible, I write objection for that. Then inquiry officer will take a decision whether to call him or not to call him. In most of the cases, inquiry officer will not agree to call recall the witness once again for examination. Unless it is really with the essence here. He should examine the defense witnesses by putting the question relevant to the case. So he bringing his own defense witnesses, he will examine them and allow those witnesses for cross-examination by the presenting officer. So when the presenting officer is cross-examining them, what questions he is asking, what answer the defense witness is giving, all those things he should carefully decision, minor, we can re-examine him again to get clarification on the confusion created by him. He should collect copies of various proceedings from the IO, so same, what PO he has done, he is doing, the same thing he has to do here also. On the completion of inquiry, he should prepare defense brief in support of his arguments and the evidence that has come on the record with the inquiry assessment to the IO, the given time. So, how this presenting officer is giving them his brief, the PO's brief, similarly, the defense also, the inquiry officer should give his defense brief to the IO. He has to give his defense brief. So, to prepare the defense brief, he has to get one copy of the PO's brief. He can demand from the PO's brief, what PO is telling. How he is proving the charge, basing on the evidence. So he should know. So that's why PO brief, the copy will be given to the defense helper by the inquiry officer. So basing on that, he will prepare his defense brief and submit to the inquiry officer. That report should be given within the time. Normally 10 or 15 days should be given. So that within that time, he has to submit that. But here, though it is not a defense brief, the PO need not be, the defense helper need not sign it. To sign by the CE. CE only should sign. He did not sign it. So, within that, the defense helper's role is over. Once he submits the defense brief to the inquiry officer, his role is over. So, PO's role is over. When the defense helper's role is over, the charge number's role is over. When defense helper is there, charge number need not mark anything, he has to see. So, their roles are over. Now, the role of the inquiry officer. Let us see what is the role of the inquiry officer. The IO is appointed head to assist the discipline authority in judging the case correctly. So here, the discipline authority has issued the judgment. As for those, the discipline authority can conduct the inquiry itself. He himself can conduct the inquiry as inquiry officer. But it is not possible for discipline authority to conduct the inquiry because he will be busy with his work. And he cannot do justice to the case if he conducts the inquiry because he is a judge. So that's why he nominated some subordinate officer or supervisor to conduct the inquiry. So it is the job of the inquiry officer to assist the discipline authority to understand the case and correctly take a decision in the case. He conducts inquiry and submits his report to the DA to take a different decision. Here he conducts the inquiry and submits his report to the discipline authority to take independent decision. He should hold in-depth inquiry to two purposes. The in-depth inquiry he has to conduct hearing. Conducting inquiry means he will not question anybody. He will not question the witness, he will not cross-examine the witness. He will not do that. But he has to facilitate both the PO as well as the defense helper or charge employee to bring out the correct facts of the case after holding the inquiry in accordance with the fiscal procedure. So he should make all arrangements to the PO to see that the truth should come to the light. And to ensure an impartial and fair hearing to the charged employee. So, this presenting officer is nominated by the discipline authority. This IO is also nominated by the discipline authority. Naturally, the charged employee will have in mind that all these people are against me. They are in favor of the charges. They want to prove the charges. Like that, he may be having the clear in his mind. So, here, the employee officer should clear the doubt from the charged employee's mind. He has to clearly tell to the charge of employee or he has to show to the charge of employee that if impartial, if there is a reasonable opportunity to be given the inquiry to the charge of employee to defend his case, if he wants any additional documents, he should not delay. If they are relevant, he should ask the people to produce them. If he wants to bring any witnesses, he should not delay the defense witnesses. He should allow the defense witnesses for examination and cross-examination. So like that, every reasonable opportunity should be given to the charge of to prove his innocence in the case. So that is the prime role of the inquiry officer. He should not delegate the performance process. So inquiry officer, once it is nominated, he only should see the inquiry and conduct this inquiry. He should not ask some of his subordinates or some of his colleagues to do that work for him and give the report so that he can sign. No, it is not correct. He only should sit in the inquiry all the time. And he should only sign the report, he should only prepare the report. The preparation report also, he should only do. He should not go to somebody else to prepare the report based on the evidence recorded in the inquiry. That is not correct. He should give every reasonable opportunity to charge the plate to prove his innocence in the inquiry. He should name all the relevant defense documents submitted by the CE in support of his defense. And he should allow CE to produce his witnesses if they are relevant to the case. I don't know. he should bring must prepare all documents in support of the charges, and those permitted for defense. He should bring must prepare all the documents in support of the charges, and those permitted for defense. So all documents should be brought up. He should not send letters to the assembly. He should send letters to the company supervisory officials to review the witnesses working under their control to attend the inquiry, proper identification details, and pass the issue passes to the trial from their working place to the inquiry place and go back. So this is the job of the inquiry officer. So inquiry officer to issue the letters to the supervisory officials and ask them to review the witnesses, both prosecution witnesses as well as defense witnesses, to come and attend the inquiry. The superintendent officials also should not refuse it. They have to compulsorily review them. Because it is a railway case, it is not the railway work only. The superintendent officials cannot say that, I will not review, I am having a lot of work like that, he cannot tell. He has to review the witnesses. What are any inspection is there, any urgent case is there, any determined case is there, and if the witnesses, presence is prepared at workplace means that, then he can ask the inquiry officer to first go to the inquiry of some other case, not of some sort of reason, and the next inquiry date, he will review that, he can tell. So like that, the he has to inquire officer to ensure the presence of the witnesses. But him, the BO will also help him. He should issue relieving letters to the witnesses after the inquiry to report back to them. Once the inquiry is over, the witnesses will be reviewed by the inquiry officer to go back to their workplace. They have to go back and report to the superintendent officials. He should prepare the diary order sheet indicating everything that has happened each day of the inquiry, signing append signatures of the visiting officer, captured by the witness center. Submit the same to the DA office. So daily order sheet is very, very important. What has taken place on the day? Weekly has the right and take the signature of all the parties that are present in the room on the day. That is AO, charged employee, defense chairman, and inquiry officer. You should sign and these daily order sheets to be imposed to the inquiry report and submitted to the disciplinary body. We should record oral evidence for the prosecution witnesses and defense witnesses by allowing information and cross examination by two parties. I told you, and all questions are asked, those questions will be denied to the judge, they would be. Whatever answers the witnesses are giving, those answers also will be denied to the judge, they would be. So that he has to ensure. He should not examine or cross examine the witnesses. So, in front of the officer, he cannot examine or cross examine the witnesses. He only listens to the witnesses. He can go, he can do so if no BO is appointed and he has to pay the role of the BO. In some cases, what will happen? The disciplinary officer will not appoint the BO. He will ask the inquiry officer to act as a BO officer and the IO as well as BO officer. Some cases it will happen. So then, the IO himself will take the role of the BO and do all the work of the BO in the inquiry. So here, the IO will take the both roles. As well, the inquiry officer is working as a BO means. What will happen? BO job is to do the job. IO job is neutral person. So once I was occupied by the thought of doing the charge, then he cannot do the justice to the work as I was. So that's why in every case it is better to appoint the inquiry officer, presenting officer, to present the case. But due to shortage of hands, due to shortage of other various other things, in some cases the PO will not be nominated. That role has to be placed with the IO. He should stop the inquiry to CE makes allegations of bias. Sometimes what will happen? The CE will say that, sir, you are not properly conducting the inquiry, you are not making any objections to what PO is doing. So that's why it appears that you are in the part to prove the charge. You are not working impartially. But first, you are working impartially. You are not working impartially. You are working partially. That's why you will not do that justice to me. So that's why I don't want you as inquiry officer. So you are having bias in nature. So that's why I don't want to sit in the inquiry. A representation to the IO. So once the charge judge employee expresses that this inquiry officer will not do the justice to him, then the inquiry officer immediately stop the inquiry and take the representation for the charge judge employee and all the records he should present to the presenting officer to take it to the disciplinary authority for examination and renomination of another inquiry officer. Renomination of inquiry officer will be done by the next agent, not disciplinary authority, it will be done by the revising as per rules. So, he should not go ahead, he should not force the charge judge employee, oh, I want you to conduct the inquiry, you should sit in the inquiry, you should not tell him. Once the employee loses the confidence of the inquiry officer immediately should stop the inquiry and he should hand out the papers to the disciplinary authority and he should be free from the inquiry. Again, if the content authority nominates him to conduct the inquiry, then he has to start other line. Some other person will come and start the inquiry from the state within which he has to stop. Again, he will not conduct the inquiry from the beginning. So he will start the inquiry from where he is now. After examination, cross examination of the witnesses, he should inform the charging authority in general to enable him to explain the circumstances. So, inquiry of the completion of the information cross-examination of all prosecution and defense witnesses, then inquiry officer can put some questions to the charging employee. He can put the questions such as, provided empire agrees for that. He can put the question to them. If the empire says that, no sir, I don't want the information by you, so whatever I wanted to tell, I will tell in my defense brief. He may tell like that. So, then he need not question the charging employee. He should carefully analyze the evidence recorded in him and make correct and proper assessment of the evidence. This is very, very important job of the inquiry officer. So, entire evidence has come on the record, model evidence has come on the record, arguments have come on the record, and viewpoints of the PO, viewpoint of the defense helper, everything has come on the record. Confusing, it will be told whether it is correct, it is wrong, whether it applies responsible or not. A lot of confusion will be there. That's why carefully he has to read each and every point in the case. And then he has to have with the proceedings. He should come to a conclusion whether it's approved or not approved. To mention it in the part, he has to be successful. He should write his inquiry report giving points and findings whether charges are approved or not approved. Clearly, he has to tell charges are approved, charges are not approved. Clearly, he should tell. May be proved, can be proved, all these words he should not be. Specifically, he has said, the charge is approved or not approved. Article 1 is approved or not approved. Article 2. Is good or not good. Clearly, partially proved, that is also not permitted. Partially proved, not partially proved, all these things should not be there. So, good or not good. He should clearly tell in his report. Broadly, his report should consist of these four subheadings: brief history of the case, discussion of evidence, reasons for findings, and findings. Brief history of the case, you know very well what is the case. He writes it briefly. Then, discussion of evidence. What are the evidences of come during the course of the inquiry? What are the arguments of come? What are the answers are recorded in the inquiry? All those things we will discuss in this paragraph. Then reasons for findings. So before coming to the findings, there will be some reason for him. Logical reason will be there. And what logical reason he will go into the findings. So that we have to discuss here. Reasons for findings here. Then findings. Findings should be very specific. Article charge number so-and-so, charge is good. Charge so-and-so, that's a charge is not. Sometimes they say, inquiry officer, they say, Article 1 is good, Article 2 is good, like that. No. Charge should be verbatim be written. What is the charge? Verbatim be written, and then he should say that the above charge is true or not true. He has to write. That is a correctly inquiry. If he wants to tell any other thing to DA, notice during the inquiry, he can do the same separately under the heading of matters brought to light. This should not be noted as CD or so. But then he has noticed something in the course of the inquiry. So he has observed something in the course of the inquiry. Not only this employee, other employee also involved in this case. This may come to the notice of the inquiry officer. That he has to bring into notice of missing authority separately or separately seen under the heading of what matter first night. That should not be known to the CE, capital play, or defense. So, basing on this matter, what you like, the missing authority can take a decision before participant reaction in some other case. Or sometimes the inquiry officer can suggest some system improvement in the house. Because of system failure, there may be some mistakes of taken case. So that he can bring to notice of that. This is for that to get the correct charge. So that the same thing again need not be repeated in the working. So all these things here. So this is once you start doing, take any case and start doing the inquiry, then you can understand. A lot of things will take place. So very deeply it goes. Because no employee here wants punishment, so naturally he will be trying to get out of this headache, get out of this problem, get out of this case. So that's why he will be trying. So also, he is trying to do the job. So it is very hard. Efforts only one can complete the inquiry properly. Otherwise, the entire case will go in vain. If the case goes to the court, the should be on the report, proper resume opportunity should be given, and finding should be very large, the finding should be given in the inquiry office. This is the role of the inquiry office in presenting
the
inquiry office. This is complete. So if you have any doubts, ask me, I will clarify.
Participants, now you can ask any doubts. Sir, there is a question in the chat box. Any special casual leave or permission? Special leave or permission for defense counsel?
It is not special casual leave. It is special leave. Special leave. When the defense helper is coming for the inquiry, he will be sent on duty only. So he is eligible for TADA, duty pass for traveling, and he can be provided accommodation also supervisor station. All the privileges are there for the defense. So the duty will be treated as duty only.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, madam.
Sir, I just want to ask one thing. Just initially you have said about the punishment and all. If somebody dies with a punishment, NCE, that is non-cumulative. So will his settlement dues will be fixed with the having deferring his further pension benefits?
You know very well that we calculate the pension exactly based on the pay last draft with the employee. Before submitting the appeal to the appellate assembly, the employee dies. His family members can submit the appeal, his wife can submit the appeal to the appellate assembly, asking the appellate assembly to cancel the remaining portion of the money penalty so that he can get the restore and basically the restore of pay his settlement is getting arranged. Whatever family pension and they will get the money to be arranged, it can be arranged or not.
Sir, you have said about some time limit, that is 45 days.
45 days from the date of receipt for the penalty order. So here what will happen, receipt for the penalty today, he passes the order in the file, and today he will sign the penalty order. But then, if you reach the return of the day after tomorrow, half this week. So, once this penalty order is served on the employee, his appointment is obtained and kept in the record, kept in the file, number 5. So from the date of appointment only, this 45 days will be completed.
Okay, but in our division, in few cases, we have seen there is a pick and choose where some officers, they forego, that means they ensure the punishment. Some, after the death, because I look after the death cases after an advance review, during the advance review, I come to know that some cases with NC punishments, their punishment has been censured and he was treated, his pay was treated as if there was no punishment.
Yes,
there is also a belief that the day of termination, that means the termination of punishment. Is that true or correct, sir? Because the date of death means his punishment is over.
Yeah.
Can we take it like this? Because he has died, his punishment is censured.
It is not automatically. Suppose 1 year penalty is given. Within 6 months, while undergoing the penalty, he dies within 6 months. Automatically, you can say that the remaining portion of the penalty is cancer. Can I say?
Yeah, this is what?
All of the disadvantages are 1 year within. So, if it is reduced to 6 months by the higher authority, that is the appellate or releasing authority,
we cannot actually treat it that the punishment is over by 6 months.
No, actually, my thing is that whenever the punishment is issued, it is written NC punishment with no future, pensionary benefits will not be disturbed. Some sort of language is being used. So, but when the when the employee dies, the family should not be punished with this thing, na? They should get the...
Yes, ma'am. What you are telling, with the employee retiring on superannuation, we know when he is going to retire.
Yeah.
So, penalty is imposed on him for certain period. Certainly, it is going to affect his pension benefit that we will be knowing well in advance because employee is going to be retiring on superannuation. But in death cases, we cannot anticipate that. So, yes, happened. So, that's why as on the death, so what way he was drawing, basically, on that only, we have to arrest the certain benefits. So, as on the death, he was accepting the penalty and his pay was reduced. So, whatever reduced pay he was drawing on the day of death, basically, on that only, we have to arrest that. That's why employee is not available, so appeal to the applied authority are releasing the card. So the
money
has been given to the wife of the employee, if it is a male employee. So the wife or husband in the case of female employee, they can appeal to the applied authority, explaining the situation. So there is every possibility that the applied authority may consider the request of the person and the remaining portion of the penalty can be cancelled. So that then the family can get the penalty benefit.
So there is no mandatory rule that he will do. In some cases, there is a pick and choose that. Some appellate authority has ensured that punishment. Some, they stood by, they said, no, we will not. So this thing...
Most of the cases will go by the sympathy. Because when the employee himself is not there, but when the punishment
comes in, exactly.
The pension is granted. Yes, sir. Many of the appellate authorities, they are not there. Sometimes they can understand this. They may do something for them because they the remaining portion anyhow the employee will not undergo the penalty. There will be no more. So that's why they can cancel the remaining portion of the penalty to enable the family to get the money.
Okay, sir. Thank you. It's all up to them, na? Right, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Sir, there is one more doubt in the chat box. If the charged employee was involved in a criminal case, under court procedures, this was retired from government service, denying to attend the inquiry. How to close the case?
Once again, please tell me, I could not hear properly.
If the charged employee was involved in a criminal case,
yes,
it is under court procedures. Witness was retired from government services, denying to attend inquiry. How to close the case?
It may happen because the witness is not there, he has already retired. Even retired employee also should attend the inquiry as a prosecution witness whenever he is summoned. Because you know very well, future good conduct is one of the conditions for the pension. So, this comes under that. So, just because you are retired, you are not totally gone out of the railways. You are taking railway pension. So, you should attend the inquiry on behalf of their administration and whatever you know that you are summoned for confirmation of your statement. So, every facility is provided to him for traveling as well as accommodation as well as the TADA. So, he has to come and do that. If he is not doing that, then suddenly there is possibility to take action against him. And one more thing what will happen if the retired employee is not in a position to come to the inquiry officer's base. To view the evidence, inquiry officer himself can fix the inquiry at the place where this retired employee is staying. So, just he is from there, suppose he is staying in Salem, he is staying in Chennai, but inquiry is being conducted in Chennai. But he need not come to Chennai. The inquiry officer himself can go to the Salem and there he can conduct the
Thank you very much, sir, for giving information on your inquiry and helping the participants to know more about this. Thank you very much. I also thank all the participants.